Thanks also to Dr. Ayman Rahmani for both of you for organizing and inviting us to this nice conference. Also, I'm pleased to be following Dr. Barbara Schmidt, who finished her talk talking about ethics of research. And I will continue talking about ethics at the age of viability in our neonatal population. I have nothing to disclose financially. My objectives of the talk today is to talk about ethical principle and how they apply in neonates. I will discuss question at the age of viability, explain best interest of the patient as a concept, and then discuss factors affecting decision making at the age of viability, and then discuss some approach for the age of viability. I will start with this research done by Jonathan Tanaroff, who this is published in 2014 under the title The Ethics and Practice of Neonatal Resuscitation at the Limit of Viability, an International Perspective. Neonatologists attending an international meeting were surveyed about the delivery room behavior. And let me explain this slide, because that is the main result of the study. So what they ask people is, what do you do? Do you start full resuscitation, everything? A. B, you start with pulmonary resuscitation, but you don't go to cardiac intervention. That is B. C, you withhold the resuscitation. You will not provide resuscitation. So A, full resuscitation. B, partial. C, withhold resuscitation. And then they give different scenarios. And in each scenario, the baby could be 22 weeks or 23 weeks or 24 weeks. So the scenarios are divided into a high-risk scenario, like a male with no steroid, or a good scenario that the baby is active, or a female who received the steroid. So, and they looked at the response of people, what they do. So if you look at one bad scenario, or a high-risk scenario, where a male without a steroid, and we take 22 weeks, then we see that most people choose C, which is not to allow resuscitation. While if the baby is active and crying, and yet the 22 weeks, the same people would be divided between giving full resuscitation, partial, or no resuscitation. While if it's a female who have steroids, some of them will give resuscitation at 22 weeks, and most people still not giving resuscitation. If the patient is very hypoactive, bradycardic, not responding from the beginning, then most people at 22 weeks offer no resuscitation. If you look at the 24-week in green, everybody want to give resuscitation, except in scenario number four, there is some distribution. Where for 23-weeker, there was always some distribution between giving or not giving for resuscitation. So the conclusion of the study, there were strong preference for comfort care at 22 weeks and full resuscitation at 24 weeks. And resuscitation was in a gray area at 23 weeks. And also they asked them some questions and conclude that there is many cultural, social, legal factors that determine the behavior of the neonatologist and their decision regarding the age of viability. So what are the management options do we have? We now understand we have either to go for full support or go to withholding of support, not initiating therapy, or start a therapy, then evaluate, and then decide if we want to continue or withdraw. And in some ethical dealing with end of life, some people do active termination of life, which is not very popular among the neonatal population, we don't want to discuss. Now, with this type of decision, that takes us to the ethics of regarding our decision. And now I will start to, what is the definition of ethics? So there is no clear definition of ethics, but ethics is maybe the tool that we know the right from wrong, that we kind of compare the right thing from the wrong thing. Or maybe ethic is things are ethical when they are good for us, when they add good thing to our life, and unethical when they add bad thing or make our life worse. Now, we wish always to look at things from black and white, very clear demarcation that this is ethical, this is non-ethical. But when it comes to our question about neonatal care and ethics related to it, unfortunately, we go into the gray color. And things are not very clear, and we should work together to reach to the best decision to be offered for the patient and the family. So what are the principles of ethics that we need to apply or think of when we are talking about medical decision? There are four principles to remind everybody in the audience to know regarding ethical principle: autonomy, beneficence, non-maleficence, and justice. And let's see how these would apply into the neonatal population. If you look at the autonomy, for example, related to neonatal care, then the autonomy by definition is the right to accept or refuse a treatment, but a neonate cannot do this. So should we treat all newborn, give them full treatment because their will is unknown? Or do we always have to respect the parent autonomy as they are the surrogate for their children? What about the best interest of the baby? Can this be contradicting with the parent wish? Also, should we consider the best interest of family? Because the child is part of their family, and we should consider them one unit and look at them as a holistic approach. And when and how can we contradict parent decision, especially more challenging in certain culture and certain country? Now, we're talking about parental autonomy. Let's just discuss it a little bit more. Parents have the right to get the information they need to make an informed decision on their child's behalf. They have the right to decide what is the best done to their child. Their decision may be overridden by the child's rights. We have to be advocate for children. And that happens when the parent refuse a treatment that we think is clearly of benefit to their children, or sometimes they demand a treatment that is clearly harmful. And that is more common scenario because parents are not trained or educated to be a physician or medical professional. The second principle and its application to the neonatal population are two principles: beneficence and non-maleficence. And that's basically what we say, the best interest of the child, not to give them benefit and not to harm them. So when the prognosis is so poor, resuscitation or any intervention is useless, then it is not allowed. So the prognosis decides what is of benefit for the child. When the prognosis is good, that in that scenario, resuscitation should be provided and should be obligatory. But the problem, the prognosis sometimes is unclear, and it's difficult to determine the relative benefit and burden of the resuscitation. And that is where the gray zone happens. And we need to do a shared decision and different approach. Let's talk about best interest or in neonate. Do you think that keeping life with potential morbidity and its burden a good thing for the baby? You should resuscitate regardless of the outcome, regardless of the future of these children. Also, we should distinguish between parent and baby suffering. Both of them should be considered, but the baby suffering also should be thought of because they're lacking autonomy. The second thing we have to think about is the developmental outcome score that we measure and decide on are dependent on when do we take it. If you take it at 2 years, might change at 4 years, might change at 10 years. If you get a developmental outcome at 10 years, it's reflecting a neonatal care 10 years ago. If you take a developmental and outcome at 20 years, it reflects the care in the late 90s and early 2000. So it's very tricky when we are talking about prognosis and outcome in the neonatal period. The other thing about best interest is very subjective. And one important point is physicians are very highly achieving human, and we are the one who do the counseling. And we think the standard is to have a child that will have high IQ and high achievement. So we may be subjectively biased when we are counseling and judging quality of life. Some studies show that extreme low birth weight infants are rating their health-related quality of life comparable to the normal birth control. So they are happy with what they get. So something needs to be discussed further before we decide about offering treatment or not. Justice is to treat people equally, and if there is a relevant difference between them. And many people feel that the neonatal population are treated differently than adult and even children, because some disease like car accident with children or some encephalopathic related to infectious disease might do a very much worse outcome than extreme prematurity. And yet nobody discuss withdrawal or withhold of treatment in this population. When it comes to a neonatal population, we are trying to treat them different because we think they are just a little human being maybe. So justice has to be thought of deeply when we're dealing with the neonatal decision making. There's another concept called distributed justice. People thinking that the money should not go to, you know, to be spent on certain extreme babies, and that will consume resources. But many people argue that NICU care is relatively less costly than adult. For example, very preterm babies die quickly. 70% of them, they die in the first 5 days of life. So the cost is only for a short period of time. And if you look at the NICU as intensive care bed, 9 out of 10 NICU beds are devoted to babies who survive, while 4 out of 10 in adults, they survive. And most survivors are productive citizens, with some caution about this data, because an extreme premature baby, they can have a lot of challenge in the future. So let's also see how the law people, this is a professor in law from McMaster University, and she says that natural intrinsic are to try to save all babies. So we have to try with everybody, even if the chance of survival are low. However, we do not think it is always right to put baby through the stress and pain of intensive treatment if the baby is unlikely to get better and death is inevitable. So this, I put the unlikely to get better is a probability, not a definite thing. And medicine is not a disease, a science definite answer. It's a disease of it's a science of probability. So we have to balance and think on every case by case and see what is the probability of survival and what is the probability of getting better before we decide about life and death. And that takes us to another concept that us as a neonatologist are not well trained about, and that's medical futility. In Oxford Dictionary, futility means incapable of producing any useful result or pointless. And futility means pointless or uselessness. While medical futility is defined or described as a judgment that a further medical treatment of a patient would have no useful result. So when we decide a treatment is futile, and it's pointless and it's useless, that is when we don't offer it. And that takes us to another concept that we use and we interchange, and that's viability. And viability, by simple term, is the ability to live outside the womb. Some people define it as gestational age at which survival is 50%. And currently it's around 24 weeks. So viability is 24, but we are also thinking of offering treatment at the peri-viability, because it's not zero in the lower side of the 24 weeks. But we know that gestational age is frequently used in determining the age of viability. But we have also to understand, and I'm sure most of the neonatologist audience know this, but it's just just opening some thoughts for discussion, that birth weight, gender plurality, and use antenatal steroid change the outcome. Of course, where you practice and your resources and what's your philosophy about active treatment regarding certain gestation age will determine the outcome. But when we are using gestational age as the tool for age of viability, we are hugely challenged by many things. And the main thing is the accuracy in gestation and age, because gestation and age, depending on last menstrual period, is not accurate. If we are using early ultrasound, it might be a few days to 1 week. But if a late ultrasound is used to determine the gestation and age, the accuracy can be in the range of plus minus 2 weeks, which is a huge variation that affect our decision. And if we wait for the baby to come out and have a senior doctor attending the delivery at 23 weeks, I don't think it's very easy for any of us to look at a 23-weeker and know if they are less and they are more toward the 22 weeks, or they are more and more toward a 24 weeks. So physical examination at the time of birth is not an easy tool to assess gestational age. But yet, still gestational age is used as a tool to estimate survival for extreme premature baby. And this is the NICH network calculator that gives you the outcome according to the data collected in 2000 in the year 1998 and 2003 from 19 centers in the US. It's still reflecting a US data, maybe also an elite centers in the US. And the number also, it's reflecting a different time period than what we are practicing today. Now, if we look even at this calculator and put some arbitrary, I would say, numbers, like put a 24-weeker, 500 gram, and then change risk factor, and then put a 24-weaker with 1,000 gram, and put them a favorable risk factor, we find the survival in the first one at 17%, while in the second one is 93%. So there is a huge variation in the outcome in the same gestation and age, depending of what risk factor is present at the time of birth. And this has to be, in a complex way, assessed and incorporated with the discussion with family and in the decision making, which should sometimes happen within half an hour or 2 hours when the mom rush into the ER with a fully dilated cervix and is contracting and is ready to expel a premature baby. Again, another challenge in gestational age and cutoff point of viability is outcomes changing with time. This is the Sweden data for survival. If you look at the time period from the 1985 till 2015, you can see, for example, this color represents a 23-weeker. That 23-weeker outcome is improving with time. So you cannot use the outcome in the mid-90s to counsel a resuscitation and the 2010, you will be giving the parents a false information about the outcome. The same thing for 22 weeks and even for 24 and 25 weeks. So these data is evolving, and the cutoff for what is considered an age of viability is changing with time. I cannot move on without sharing with you this New England Journal of Medicine application that was done by one pediatric resident who took the NICH data and analyzed it in further way. So they looked at between hospital variation in treatment and outcome in extreme preterm infant. And I just need 1 minute to explain this slide. So this is 22 weeks, this is 23 weeks, this is 25 and 26 weeks. And the y-axis is looking at the active resuscitation. If you look at 24, 25, and 26, most people do full resuscitation. Almost 100% resuscitation is offered. And the line here, the width of the line, reflects variation between one center and another. So there is not much of variation at the 25, 26 week, and to some extent to 24 weeks. But once we reach 23 and 22 weeks, we'll see the lines of variation is wide. Here is very wide. So some centers are giving this much rate of active resuscitation versus this much rate of resuscitation. And this even changed from 22 weeks with 5 days and 22 weeks and 6 days. Even 1 day make a difference in the approach people do. Now, how this would reflect into outcome? When they looked at the survival at 22 weeks, survival at 22 weeks, the centers that do full resuscitation, these dots, have a better survival, much better survival than the one that do not do active resuscitation. Of course, this is, yeah, it makes sense and logic. But at that, people sitting in this area think it's worthless, it's futile, and it shouldn't be tried to give resuscitation because nobody would survive. But people who tried achieve this survival. The same thing apply for 23 weeks. Centers that do less resuscitation have much less survival than the one that approach all babies with at 23 weeks and give them resuscitation. So of course, this is neurodevelopmental survival without severe impairment. So of course, these babies will have impairments, and that is probably the other, pulling fact that makes us a little bit cautious about offering resuscitation. I put this slide because when we counsel parents, we need a slide like this, a data like this. You take, this is a data from Vermont Oxford Network 2014. You take 100 babies and say, how many of them get resuscitated, for example, in that network? 88. 47 survive. So out of the 47, 20 have neurodevelopmental impairment that's significant. So we are left with from 47, 20 have neurodevelopmental impairment. We are left with 27 who are not having neurodevelopment, but 14 of them will have neurobehavioral, educational, and social impairment. So when we counsel the parents, we should be honest with them that only 13 will have normal life if you are looking at normal life. Absolutely, no impairment. So the number is different than saying 50% survivor or 60% survivor. So it has to be in a simple approach and very clear way and an updated outcome data that reflect also the local outcome in that particular hospital. So what are the approaches to the age of viability? Either to follow like legislation or a guideline or a policy in the hospital and say everybody above this gestation age, we should resuscitate and there is no DNR. But this ethically in some way violating some of the principle of the ethics, maybe all of them, because you might harm some babies and you don't respect autonomy and we may treat these people in an unfair way. Or apply ethical principle of autonomy, beneficence, and non-maleficence and justice in your way so you have some flexibility of offering treatment when it is beneficial and withhold it when it is causing harm with some respect to the autonomy. Now, other approach which use the same thing that is in the first two approach, but they have different name called ordinary, extraordinary approach, means that, ordinary is the treatment that when you offer it, you make a difference. The extraordinary treatment, it just increases the burden and the suffering and has no benefit. Shared decision approach is another approach. It's called shared decision. We share the parent with the information they need, but we support them with their decision. So that is the ordinary, extraordinary. I already explained it to you. The shared decision approach, as I said, we have to just put the parent in the context of what they are expecting and then support them. We don't negotiate with them the best interest model. We don't establish moral truth or ethics. We just go with what they feel the best for them. And in this approach, we have to be aware that there is a huge stress that will be on the parent in taking decision of life and death in their own children. And this might stay with them for the rest of their life. So we have to be very supportive and give them the best information available. In this shared decision, an initial decision to resuscitate and initiate intensive care measure is reversible. So the parent should be made aware of this, that if they go for a treatment, of course reversible if you go for the treatment and then more complication appear, then you can withdraw support. And UAE, we cannot do that because the law of the UAE doesn't allow withdrawal of care. Now for medical ethicists, they clearly believe if it would be permissible not to offer resuscitation, it would also be permissible to withdraw support. So they don't see a difference between withhold of support and withdraw of support. I will finish my talk with a few slides just sharing how the American Academy of Pediatrics tackled the problem in the beginning of the century with certain statements. So the first one is the AAP non-initiation or withdrawal of intensive care statement in 2007. And they say treatment that is harmful and of no benefit or futile and merely prolonging dying is inappropriate. So that is the frame that should we should work with in making decision. We shouldn't commit to a certain numbers or absolute, very rigid rules. We should just put in our mind that anything that is harmful without a benefit, it should be inappropriate. And the large organization supported. Also in 2009, the AAP Committee on Fetus and Newborn say the following: if physician involved believe there is no chance of survival, no chance of survival, resuscitation is not indicated and should not be initiated. So we're talking about close to zero, our belief of a zero survival. If the physician consider a good outcome to be very unlikely, the parental choice regarding resuscitation should be respected. Like if the risk of disability is very high, this where the parent have the choice to be involved in the decision. When the physician judgment is that a good outcome is reasonably likely, resuscitation should be initiated. If we look at the NRP and what they say about the age of viability, for example, in 2010, when gestational age or birth weight are associated with almost certain early death, and when unacceptable high morbidity is likely among the rare survivor, resuscitation is not indicated. Example, that is in 2010. Example include gestational age less than 23 weeks, like the 22 weeks were included, or birth weight less than 400 grams. But in 2006, NRP changed, and they said we should only withhold the treatment for a confirmed gestational age less than 22 weeks. And we have discussed that the outcome is evolving. There is more survivor among actively resuscitated 22 weeks. So in conclusion, human has the right to live and get optimal treatment. Ethical principles are challenged in the neonatal care at the age of viability. Treatment measures should focus on the best interest of the patient, but that's very tricky in this population. Viability at a specific gestational age is continuously changing with improving neonatal care, but also should be considered according to your local data and local ability in that particular country. In gray zone, the parental informed decision is very important and should be respected. I will finish with this statement from Dr. Eric Kessel, who said, physician failure to understand the nature of suffering can result in medical intervention that not only fails to relieve suffering, but become the source of suffering itself. Thank you very much for your listening.